Welcome to First Baptist Richardson. Thank you for tuning in to us today. We have something special planned in worship and can't wait to share it with you today. Let's worship together right now. About God's amazing grace.
Wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all my sin. How shall my tongue describe it? Where shall its grace begin? Taking away my burden, setting my spirit free. For the wonderful grace.
sing to get us started this morning. Let's continue to worship. Come thou fount.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me
together today. Lord hears my heart. As we continue to worship, let's read these words of encouragement together. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about the troubles we experienced in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt we had received the sentence of death. But this happened that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God, who raises the dead. He has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. On him we have set our hope that he will continue to deliver us. Then many will give thanks on our behalf for the gracious favor granted us in answer to your prayers. Now this is our boast. Our conscience testifies that we have conducted ourselves in the world, and especially in our relations with you, with integrity and godly sincerity. We have done so relying not on worldly wisdom, but on God's grace. Let's sing about what Jesus has done for us.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke.
Jesus today. So good to see all of you here today, particularly guests. We're glad you've joined us online today. But guests in the room, thank you for being here today. We have guests with us every Sunday, and we want to get to know you a little better. One of the ways we can do that is you can take your phone out and text CONNECT to the number that you see right there on your screen. That way we can get a hold of you digitally. Or right after this service, right out these doors and across our lobby is our Next Steps room. We'll have pastors and others there that would love to meet you in person and get connected with you and help you get connected with First Baptist Richardson. I'm so happy today to have a special guest in the pulpit for us. Dr. O.S. Hawkins joins us today. Dr. Hawkins was my pastor at First Baptist Dallas and a great friend of our family, and glad that he's with us. He's a native of Fort Worth. Don't ask him about the TCU game. But he has been at the annuity board, we call it Guidestone now, for our Southern Baptist Convention since 1997. Our church has a history that goes way back with the annuity board and Guidestone. We're so grateful for his service and ministry there. He has written several books that I want you to know about. In keeping with the sermon series we're in, Unstoppable, our pastor looked at two passages from the book of Daniel. Well, Dr. Hawkins has written a book called The Daniel Code that goes into depth on the book of Daniel. You might want to pick that up at Amazon or other places. Then he's also written a new book called In the Name of God. I started this on Thursday and I'm almost finished with it, which is unusual because I don't read quickly. So it's a great book. Discussing the two most important Texas Baptist preachers of the first half of the 20th century. That, you wouldn't believe the drama between the two, including both of these pastors, great pastors, both shot a man. So you can read the book to find out more about what happened there. Hey, we've got something special coming up. In fact, I need a prop. Is that the right way? Yeah. Sweet Show is coming up next Sunday night. This is our student ministry fundraiser. It's clearly got a country western theme. Our student choir are working on some great music that they'll be sharing. It's a dinner, it's a dessert auction, and we want you to be there. You can get tickets either online or you can go out to the Welcome Center or the Missions Cafe and they can help you with those tickets. So please come and support our students. It's going to be a great time next Sunday night. Hey, speaking of singing carols, Christmas is coming. We are doing carols this Christmas. I'm so happy after a year off. Christmas is back. Amen. Carols, choir, and orchestra starts this week. I wanted you to know about those things that are coming up. And church, thank you for your generous giving, the way you support and encourage the ministries of First Baptist Richardson are making a difference right here and spreading beyond this place. Thank you for your giving. Keith, come lead us in prayer.
Thank you, Andy. Let's pray. Father, your grace is sufficient. Your mercy knows no bounds. You are our strength when we're weak. When we face adversity, we have a warrior king who goes before us. When we're facing challenges, we have a comforter. Father, thank you that you love us so deeply. There are times in our lives, Father, that we need guidance. We need a shepherd. Thank you that you know our voice. We are the sheep of your pasture. And Father, help us to lead, to follow where you lead. We love you. Thank you for this grand privilege of worshiping together and singing praises to your name. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Andy, and choir and
orchestra. I've known Andy since he was a boy. And if there's a pure heart, I've never known one than Andy Schwarmer. And I preach in a different church every Sunday, somewhere across the Southern Baptist Convention mainly. And you don't hear music like this most places. I mean, it's... Now, I'll tell you what I do hear every Sunday. I hear a lot of hollering and screaming and a lot of performance. But this meant so much to me today. Thank you. Especially for two reasons. A little over 50 years ago, my wife Susie and I knelt at our wedding altar down at Hyde Park Baptist Church in Austin. And we had this song, "Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us," sung as we knelt there and prayed. And over a half a century, he's answered that prayer and blessed it. And then, I don't know whether Andy knew this or not, but, you know, I was saved when I was 17. Never heard a prayer in my home. Never saw the Bible open in my home. Didn't know Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were even books of the Bible. I was 3 months away from graduating from high school and going to TCU. And a young man witnessed to me after a ball game, basketball game one night, and took me to the Sagamore Hill Baptist Church where Fred Swank was pastor there for 43 years. And the first Christian hymn I ever sang in my life was the one we sang earlier, "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, Tune My Heart to Sing Thy Praise." And that morning I came to know Christ. My life was radically transformed. I asked the minister of music, Gerald Ray, to borrow a hymnal. I took it home that day. And on that day, just hours after my conversion, I memorized that song, "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing." And I can't tell you how many times at TCU when I was a pre-law student that I would come to Temptation's Corner and those words would come into my mind, "Prone to wander, Lord, I fear it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above." So this has been a special blessing to me, and thank you for this wonderful music that set the stage for us to open the book of God to the people of God. And let's open our Bibles to Exodus chapter 14. As we continue in this series on embracing these Red Sea moments, and we come today to one of the real mountain peaks of Scripture, the parting of the Red Sea, the deliverance of the children of Israel, and the demise of the Egyptian army who came after them. In verse 13 of Exodus 14, the Bible says, "And Moses said to the people..." Now he had heard God speak in Exodus 3 from a burning bush, saying, "Come and go back and be the emancipator of my people. Go to Pharaoh and say, let my people go." And Moses did. And God sent a series of plagues on Egypt, as you know. And we come to chapter 12, and there's that great Passover night when the death angel visits, and those are saved by the blood of the lamb over the doorpost and lintels of their homes. And now they're making their escape, and they've fled, the children of Israel, under the leadership of Moses. But they get to the Red Sea, and they look behind them, and here comes the Egyptian army approaching, the clouds of dust following all those hundreds and hundreds of chariots and those armed men of Egypt coming. And the children of Israel were in a tight spot. They couldn't go forward. They couldn't skirt around it. They couldn't swim through it. And here came the Egyptians. And Moses said to them in verse 13, "Fear not, stand firm, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. For the Egyptians whom you seem to see today, you'll never see them again." Now put yourself in the place of those Israelites. That's pretty big talk. "The Lord will fight for you, and you only have to be silent." The Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry to me? Tell the people of Israel to go forward." And he lifted up his staff, and the waters of the Red Sea rolled back on either side, to the left and to the right. and the children of Israel walked through on dry ground. And as they got to the other side, as you know, the Egyptian army in hot pursuit, their chariots bogged down and in the floor of the Red Sea, and the waters came in over them and covered them. And the children of Israel were delivered to continue their journey to the promised land. And the last words of the chapter say, so the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. You've probably heard the story of the little boy that went to Sunday school, and they came home for dinner, and they were all sitting, the family was sitting around the dining room table having lunch, and the dad turned to the little boy and he said, Johnny, what'd you hear? What'd you learn in Sunday school this morning? He said, well, our teacher taught us about the Red Sea. And his father said, well, what did he say? What did he teach you? And he said, Dad, it was incredible. He said that the children of Israel were trying to leave Egypt, and they got to the Red Sea, and they didn't know what they were going to do, and the Egyptian army was coming after them. So Moses called in all these engineers, and he said they built a pontoon bridge across the Red Sea. He said the children of Israel went across that pontoon bridge, and they got to the other side, and no more had they gotten there. They looked back, and here came all the Egyptian army across that pontoon bridge after them. He said, so Moses called in an airstrike. They blew up the bridge, and the Egyptian army drowned in the sea. And his dad said, is that what he told you? He said, well, no, Dad, but if I told you what he really said, you'd never believe it. And so that's the way a lot of people come to this story of Moses. You know, one of the things I love about your church, you got a great staff here at your church, and I know you appreciate them. And all this staff that Ellis has here is such a great staff. But I want to remind you, you're going to get to the end of this story. You know what you're going to read? It says, Moses leaned on his staff and died. So that's a word of warning. As a word of warning for you, Pastor Ellis, you better be careful as you go forward. Well, do you remember those old game shows? In fact, they're still on television. I guarantee you a lot of you watch them. Remember The Price is Right with Bob Barker? Or Jeopardy with Alex Trebek? Or Wheel of Fortune with Vanna White. I mean, I can't remember Pat's last name, but I remember Vanna White. Nobody could turn those letters like that blonde Vanna White. But let me tell you, my favorite one of all of them was Let's Make a Deal with Monty Hall. You remember, he'd have that television audience, and he'd call out someone's name, and he'd say, come on down. And they'd come down, and they'd give him some kind of a gift that didn't amount to a whole lot. But then there were three doors, three curtains usually. And so the contestant could pick one of them. Now, usually one of them was a really nice gift, like an automobile or something like that behind one of them. The others were just not very good gifts at all. And he could take the gift he had, or he could make a deal and go to one of those other doors. I was always amazed at how people responded. Some just panicked. They just wring their hands, and they'd go here, and then they'd walk over to this door. They'd walk back to this door and just panicked. Others just were paralyzed. They just stood there. And then some were just paused. They just went right up to whatever door they wanted and made their choice. When we come to Exodus 14, the children of Israel, it's almost like they were on Let's Make a Deal, but this was no game. Some of them were panicking. They were saying, I wish we'd never left Egypt. We should go back. They were just wringing their hands in panic. Let's go back. Let's go back to Egypt. Others were paralyzed. They didn't know what to do. They were facing their fears, and it looked insurmountable. The Red Sea had no way to get across. The Egyptian army was bearing down, and they had really no defense against them. Some of you are facing your own Red Sea moment today, facing your fear. May not be a Red Sea, an Egyptian army, but things seem to be closing in on you. And some of you are panicked. Some of you are paralyzed by it. And so what we want to see today in the crossing of this Red Sea is to see how the Bible is so applicable for who we are and where we are and where we're living today. because it's all about how we face our fears, how we get through our own Red Sea moment. Step one, we find it in verse 13. Moses said, "Fear not, stand firm." That's step one. You want to get through your Red Sea? First of all, stand firm. Now get the picture. They were in a vise. Here came the Egyptian army. There was the Red Sea in front of them. It was time to face their fears. It's amazing how some people face their fears. Some do it like Jonah. Jonah, his answer was to flee. He just ran in the opposite direction from the will of God for his life. Job, remember what it says about Joseph? Job. It says that, he said, "That which I feared has come upon me." That's what happens to some of us, that we become so paralyzed with a fear. You know what? I'm 74. I don't believe it, but I know. I saw my birth certificate again the other day, and it said I was. And I look back over my life, and I'm going to tell you something right now. 98% of the things I worried about never even happened. Job said, "That which I feared has come upon me." Well, the elder brother in the prodigal son story, you remember how he dealt with it? He just fumed about it. He was angry. He wouldn't go in. He just fumed. And then there was the children of Israel. They fussed. They repeated this after they got into the wilderness. "We wish we had never left Egypt," they said. "We'd be better off back there serving Pharaoh. I wish we had never left Egypt to begin with." But Moses faced his fears, and his word to the children of Israel was, "Fear not, stand firm." Take a stand. Just stand firm. You know, Paul wrote in his last letters in 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 7. He said, "God has not given us," what? "A spirit of fear." God didn't give us a spirit of fear. The devil did, but God didn't. He always has a way through. He always has a way out for us. Maybe you are up against it. And God's word for you today is right here in verse 13. The first step is to just stand firm. Stop wringing your hands in panic and being paralyzed. And as it says, fear not. Stand firm. God has a purpose and God has a plan for you. God will deliver you. Step two, be still. Look what he says in the next verse, verse 14. "The Lord will fight for you, and you only have to be silent." Be still. The Lord will fight for you. God hasn't abandoned you. God sees a sparrow when he falls. How much more does he care for you? Be still. "The Lord will fight for you," Moses said, "while you remain silent." The Red Sea in Egypt was like a vise coming in on them, but it was no time to panic. He said, just be still. That's good advice to shut out all this outside noise when you're facing your Red Sea moments. Over in 2 Chronicles 20, there was a scene where King Jehoshaphat, the Israelites were being, the people of Judah were being pounced upon by the Ammonites and the Moabites. And then he heard the people from Edom were going to join them in this great coalition. And he says in verse 12, King Jehoshaphat, "For we are powerless against this great horde. Some of you may feel like that today in your own Red Sea moment. You don't know what to do. You're powerless against this great horde. Then look what he said. "We don't know what to do, but our eyes are fixed on you." That's a good word for us. when we face our own Red Sea. We don't know what to do, but our eyes are fixed on you. That's what Moses is saying to them. The Lord will fight for you. While you remain silent, he says, just be still. Your life is going to be governed by one of two things. Outward circumstances, that's the world system. All that swirling around you, the circumstances, the situation, the outward circumstances, or inner convictions. The Word of God. You're either going to be controlled by the Word or by the world. So what happens if your life is just governed by what's going on all around you and circumstances and situations that come your way? You see, fear is not an action. You don't decide, I'm going to be fearful. It's not an action. It's a reaction. It's a reaction to people who have fear. It's a reaction to those who live their lives governed by outward circumstances and the world all around them, and difficulties come and problems come and Red Sea moments come, and we are so controlled by what's going on in outward circumstances, our reaction is to fear, to have fear, to be afraid, to panic, to be paralyzed. But I want to tell you something. If your life is governed by the Word of God, an inner conviction, not an outward circumstance. If your life is governed by the Word of God, your response will not be fear. You know what it will be? Faith. Because faith isn't an action either. You don't just decide to have faith. You don't say, I'm going to have faith. Faith is not an action. It's a reaction. It's a reaction to a life who's built on the Word of God. Isn't that what Paul said in Romans 10? He said, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. So be still. Remember who you are. Don't let these things swirling outside and around you dictate and govern how you're going to live your life today. Because if you do, you will react with fear, promise you, just like they did. But learn from Moses. He'll fight for you if you'll be silent. Just be still. And if your life is governed by the Word of God, if you stand on the promises of God and you believe God, just like it says in the last verse of 14, they believed the Lord. If you believe God, then when you come to your Red Sea moment, your reaction will not be fear, it'll be faith. Built on God's Word that you can stand on. And you'll learn the lesson of verse 14, that the Lord will fight for you while you remain silent. That's what Moses is saying. Be still. What about your Red Sea moment? How are you going to get through it? First of all, stand firm. Second, be still. And step three, finally, in the next verse, go forward. Go forward. The Lord said to Moses, verse 15, why do you cry to me? Tell the people of Israel to go forward. And we know the story. Moses lifted up his staff, and God, faithful to his word, parted the Red Sea in a miracle. And the children of Israel walked through on dry ground. And they got through to the other side, and the Egyptian army kept coming through that sea, barreling down upon them. And Moses lifted his staff when he got to the other side, and the sea came together and drowned all of those Egyptians. I heard a skeptic one time in a seminary said, talking about how that was totally impossible that it happened like that, that it was really the Reed Sea, and it was so shallow that you could walk across it. It didn't need to be. That's even a greater miracle. Because a whole Egyptian army drowned in ankle-deep water, if that's true. So, what is Moses telling us here? Moses is saying, stand firm, be still, go forward, do something. There's something for God to do. Only God can part a Red Sea. But it would have been no avail to them had they just stood there and looked at the miracle in awe, had they not gone forward. Had they not by faith, can you imagine the faith it took to walk out between those massive walls of water that had rolled up on either side, and the faith it took to take your wife and your children and to walk through those walls of water to go forward. Everything God did in that miracle was to no avail because folks didn't go forward. Do you know that a lot of miracles God has performed in your life that you never saw because you were paralyzed and you wouldn't by faith go forward? Moses said, go forward. And they did. And they were delivered. But like us, they had a hard time learning their lesson. Because what happened when they got in the promised land? The Egyptians were no longer a problem to them. They got to a place called Kadesh Barnea. And Moses sent in 12 spies to spy out the land. Now God had already told them that he had given them that land, that it was theirs. But they didn't go in and take it like he told them to. Moses got there, he sent in 12 spies, spy out the land, and they came back. 10 of them came back with a majority report. They say everything you said is true. There are grapes. It's a land flowing with milk and honey, but there's no way we can get in there. There's no way we can take it. There are walled cities over there. There are giants, and they make us look like grasshoppers in their sight. We cannot do it. You see, those 10, their lives were governed by those outward circumstances. And so they reacted with fear. But there were two others. A minority report. Joshua and Caleb, remember them? They came back and they said everything those guys say is true. But they left out something. God promised us that was our land. And we can do it. Let's go forward. We can do it. And you know what they did? They took the majority report. And they wandered for 40 years in a wilderness. Until all 10 of those spies that were faithless died off. And finally then Joshua, alongside Caleb, led them in to the promised land. What are we saying? We're saying that the Bible says that God has not given us this spirit of fear. Go forward by faith. The Red Sea wasn't the problem. It was parted. Later, they faced Goliath under the kingship of Saul. Goliath wasn't a problem unless you focused all your attention on him like Saul did. But David came along, stood on the word of God and didn't see him as a problem. Saw him as a solution. Go forward. So what happened? Well, the children of Israel stood firm. They were still. They heard Moses say, the Lord will fight for you while you remain silent. Some of you in a deal with somebody right now, you need that verse. You need to know that. You're trying to figure it all out. Listen, the Lord will fight for you if you remain silent. Be still. And third, they went forward. By faith, they stepped through those walled waters of the sea, and God made a way out of no way. Some of you are facing your own Red Sea, and like a contestant on Let's Make a Deal, you're just wringing your hands, panic, not knowing what to do, where to go, how to do it. Some of you are just paralyzed by this fear. But God has a way of making a way out of no way. How does it work? How do you face your fears? Stop running. Stand firm. Stop wringing your hands. Be still. Stop being paralyzed by it. Go forward. Do something. Step out by faith. Some of you in this room today may need to receive Christ as I did as a 17-year-old young man or watching online right now. It's the same way.
Stand firm. Stop your running from God. He brought you to this place. Be still. Listen to his still small voice saying, come, you blessed of my Father. Inherit the kingdom from which was prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And go forward. By faith, say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Moses stood there, lifted up his staff, and the sea rolled back, and they walked through on dry ground. God is with you. So the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. If you continue to allow those outward circumstances to govern your life, you're going to respond like these children of Israel in fear. If you'll stand on the word of God, believe God, learn these lessons of the Red Sea from Moses, your reaction will be faith. And the Bible says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. You say, what'll I do? Stand firm. Be still. The Lord will fight for you while you remain silent. And go forward. And the Lord will be with you. He's faithful to keep his promise to you. Father, seal these words in our hearts today is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Hawkins. Thank you for that reminder that we are not alone. Take a minute and just look at the person to your right. Now, right now, you're probably looking at the back of their head because they're looking at the person to their right, but you know who that is. Look at the person to your left. Here's a great reminder for us. The two people you just looked at are facing challenges of their own today. Look at them with compassion and remember, they were both looking at you. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be silent. Thank you, Lord, that you know exactly what we're going through in our lives, that you're already there. You are already beginning to part the Red Sea so that we can move through on dry ground. Amen? And I don't know about you. I was probably like the little Israelite boy that his dad had to go back and grab him as they went through, because who wouldn't want a fish right there? They're right there. We're glad that you were with us today, and I hope and pray that the Lord spoke to you through his word. There are several ways that you can respond. Some of you may be looking for a church home. We would love to visit with you right out here at our Next Steps room. You can also come and visit with Dr. Hawkins and meet him and thank him for that message. If you're looking for information, for direction on how to meet Christ, how to know this Savior that loves you and died for you, there will be people there who can visit with you as well. If you have not yet gotten connected to one of our groups, one of our groups from all ages, if you can go to the welcome desk, which is right in the middle of our lobby. They've got lists there that can help direct you to a place where people will love you and walk with you through everything that you're facing. So we would love to visit with you at the Next Steps room, and I hope that you'll join us there. Andy's going to lead us in a closing song, and God bless you for being here today. Thank you, Andy.
Oh, We're glad you were with us today. We'd really love to connect with you. And if you'd like to find out more information about our church, how you can get connected, you can text CONNECT to the number down below. I also want to be sure you know about The Well. We're all reading a chapter in God's Word every day and journaling about it and sharing our experiences with one another. If you're interested in joining us on that, join us on our Facebook page at fbcr.org/thewell. Thank you for being with us.
If you're in the Dallas area, we want to meet you. So go ahead and show up in person at 9:30 for Classic or Contemporary. We would love to meet you.
Thanks for joining us in worship today. I pray that God has blessed you in a special way, and I can't wait to see you again next Sunday.